Hello and welcome to this evening's seminar on statistics and in more detail on statistical inferences. The webinar will be focusing on looking at sampling distributions and going from sample proportion to population proportion, looking at confidence intervals and also standard error. The webinar is hosted by Texas Instruments. So why the webinar? Because you can watch it live, but it is also recorded, and then you can ask questions live, but you can watch it later and pause and rewind and so on. So we also have PD certificate for you that you have watched the webinar, which will be provided by at the end of the webinar. And shortly you will be viewing the presenter's desktop, but if you want to ask a question during the webinar, you can do it using the chat or question and answer, and you can either contact one of the presenters or the host and we'll try to answer your question. So that's question and chat here. And you can listen to the webinar via your computer. And however, if you prefer to use your phone, this is the toll-free number and the meeting number, 828-831-831, if you prefer to use your phone. And if you, during the webinar, need to do something else and you want to come back to the webinar, you need to look for the Globe and Cisco WebEx, and then it will appear. So now it is my pleasure to introduce our panelists for tonight. Our first panelist is Frank Moya. Hello, Frank.
Hello. Hi, Bishina.
It goes too fast, unfortunately. So Frank is a T-cubed instructor and he's a mathematics consultant with many years of teaching experience at senior levels in Victoria, teaching mathematical methods and specialist mathematics. And he has recently worked as mathematics consultant and was involved in teacher support and curriculum development. And his passion is designing rich tasks and investigations for the students to introduce new concepts. I'm sure Frank will show us lots of interesting activities. Our second panelist for tonight is Peter Fox from Texas Instruments Australia. And Peter also has many years of teaching math at senior levels, as well mathematical methods and specialist mathematics. And now he works with Texas Instruments and provides training and support for teachers. He's very passionate about the technology, CAS technology, and how to use it in the classroom. So now we'll go to Peter to see his desktop, and he will make a start. So I'm passing the ball to, hold on, I need to stop sharing my desktop.
Seeing my desktop now?
Yeah.
Thank you, Regina. Okay, so the idea of this first section that I'm introducing is that people will hopefully be able to follow along a little bit on their device, on their calculator or software, depending on which one they're using. But the first thing I want to do is set up a scenario. So the scenario we have tonight, and sorry that it's dinner time and this might cause people to get a little bit hungry, we're going to be talking about chocolate beanies. So there's a lovely company called Chocolate Works, for those of you that live in Melbourne metropolitan area. They make things like polywaffles, for those that remember those, the authentic polywaffles. They also make chocolate beanies. Now, the chocolate beanies that they make come in packs of 100. You can buy them in larger packs and smaller packs if you like, but we're going to look at the ones that they distribute in packs of 100. The reason why will become obvious later on. Now, they make them in 8 different colors. So they mix up a huge batch of red ones, a huge batch of green ones and blue ones and orange ones, and then they mix them all together. So we can assume that our population is approximately infinite. They do make a lot. And we'll assume that they're distributed evenly with those colours. So therefore, we would expect to see 1/8 of the beanies in a packet being blue and 1/8 being red and so on. Now, for those doing the maths, you know that it won't be exactly 1/8 in each case unless they're cutting them in half. So Alex purchases a pack and counts the quantity of blue ones. He likes the blue beanies, so he's going to separate them out. So what can we do with that information? If we're thinking about what the students have probably covered in class already, it would be probability. And if they haven't done it this year yet, they may have already done it last year. So let's have a look at this situation as a binomial probability. So if we say P represents the probability of a blue beanie in his bag of 100, because he hasn't counted them yet, but he's interested in what he might get, then 1 minus P would be the probability of not getting a blue one. So these things are familiar to students already. So if we choose N beanies at random, then we're interested in the quantity of blue beanies, then we can say that this is binomially distributed as such. And let's have a look. If we said that we wanted to know what is the probability that Alex draws or gets 18 out of the 100 beanies being blue, so in his bag, what's the probability? I'm going to swap across to the calculator. And on the calculator application, we can choose probability. And we can see that there are distributions. And we don't immediately see binomial, but we can see it down the bottom. And we see binomial PDF. Now, rather than going through there, because you may not know the syntax for it, let me just show you another way. The first time you might want to take students in through here is through the catalogue. And I'll press B for binomial, and I can see down here binomial probability, and it gives me the syntax down the bottom of the screen. So if I put in my sample size of 100, or N is 100, the probability of P is 1/8, and I need 18 of them is what we've been asked to find out. What is the probability that 100 trials with a probability of success being 1/8, what is the probability that his bag contains 18 beanies? So we see that that probability is actually quite small, about 3% chance that he's going to get 8 beanies. So the probability is small. We kind of expected that might be the case. So there it is with the syntax on it, and we've seen how to do it on the calculator, and something that the students hopefully have already done. So let's, on the other hand, look at the fact that he's opened up his bag and indeed has counted 18 blue beanies. This is no longer a probability. It's a statistic. And I guess if we wanted to draw some sort of analogy to statistics, we could say that there's a small chance that in the event that you're crossing the road, you might get run over. That's a probability. But if you actually do get hit, then you become a statistic. So that's a nice way for students to, well, it's not a nice way. It's a way for students to remember it. So we're now looking at a descriptive statistic. That is, the proportion of blue beanies in this sample was 18 over 100. That's the sort of stuff students might have done in year 8 and 9. Looking at statistics and counting how many things were in something and so on. So the next thing we're going to have a look at is what we call inferential statistics. And what we're saying there is that from the probability, we know that that was unlikely. But with just the one sample of 100 beanies and seeing that 18 of them were blue, what sort of statements can we make about the population? We also refer to this as a point estimate of the true population proportion. So we're saying that 18 out of 100 is an estimate, of what the true population proportion might be. And in this case, because we saw before that that probability is not very likely, we might start to question whether or not it really is an even distribution of the colours. But, of course, we would need to have a look at some more samples to be more certain about that, because one bag doesn't give us a strong argument. And once we start looking at one bag, how much variability will we see from these different samples? And that's what we refer to as our sampling distribution. So we start to take samples and we see how those numbers vary from trial to trial, and we might plot them out and form a distribution, so a plot of all of those points. So let's continue. Oh, and one other thing, and what sort of uncertainty do we have around a sample once we start quantifying things? So let's set the scenario. Alex's teacher, Stephen, has two methods classes and decides to buy each of his students, 50 students, a bag of these beanies. So that will give us some idea of a distribution of this sample. Let's see how we can set that up. So I'll go back to the calculator. So if you're following along with your calculator, we started off with just a binomial PDF. This time we're going to do something different. Now I'll show you the two places to get it. There's probability, and this time, rather than going to distributions where I went before, where we're doing a probability, we're actually looking at generating a random sample. And the sample we're doing, as before, is binomial sample. And that's how we bring it up. So there's the command. But if you're not sure what numbers to type in, I'll go back to my catalog and I'll put R for random. And there it is there, random. And you'll see down the bottom of the screen, it tells us the syntax. So N, in this case, is the number of beanies in our sample. So if we look at the one bag that Alex took initially, it had 100 beanies in it, and we were told that there's a 1 in 8, or we suspect it's 1 in 8 because they're evenly distributed, so let's try that. So 100 beanies in our sample, and the sample proportion we suspect is 1 8th. And it says, well, in the first bag you opened up, you got 9. And all I need to do is press enter again, and I've taken another sample. So in the second bag I opened, I counted 5 blue ones. And next time I did it, I counted 14 blue ones, and so on. But now we want to start recording those events. Now you saw in the syntax, I can take more samples. I don't have to keep on pressing enter. I could now say, in his class, his teacher says that there's 50 bags being distributed. So now I could have a look at 50 samples. And if I drew that on a graph, then I would have a sampling distribution. So to do that, to save time, I'm just going to call it S, my sample. Now if I store those numbers, it's kind of weird to try and change that. So I'm going back to here, and I'm just going to call up that command so I can use it again. I'll press enter, and it's generated another 50 samples. Another 50 samples of 100 beanies per bag. So let's have a look. If I insert, go to my home screen, put in a scatter plot, come down here, and the quick way to get down the bottom in your scatter plot is just press tab, and then enter. And coincidentally, our blue beanies are now displayed on the screen. So there's our distribution. That's a sampling distribution. And we can see, as hopefully most of you already know, that there is some sort of a normal distribution happening here. And that's what Frank and I are going to investigate tonight. And we're kind of talking about the central limit theorem here for those of you who have already read a little bit ahead. So let's suppose I wanted to take another sample. Well, not just one, another 50 samples. The problem that we've got here is that was static. So what I'm going to do is just highlight it, Control-C, will copy that information for me. So I've copied the command, and I'm going to put in a notes page. And if you've been tuning into these webinars, you'll have seen that we're using these note pages quite a lot. And in here, I'm going to insert a math box. The shortcut is Control and M, M for math. And then Control V allows me to paste that command in there, which at this stage is not serving any great purpose other than it just did another sample, but we will see where we go with that. So make sure you paste it inside a math box. And you can see our sample might look a little bit different, but it's hard to see because we've just swapped pages. We'd rather see this happening live. See, here's how we make it happen live. We could split the page and just keep on pressing enter, but here's a cool way because we want to change a few other bits and pieces as well. So on the menu in my statistics application, I'll insert a slider and I'm going to put some value, let's say S. Oh, I can't put S because that was my name. I'll put, let's say Q for quantity. And let's start with 50 students in the class as we had. So I'm going to change my minimum to 50. We'll see some of these reasonings later. And I'll change the maximum out to 500. And I'm going to start with a step size of 1 and minimize it. I don't need to see too much about my slider. At this stage, clicking on that's not going to do anything because it's not linked. But if I go back to my notes page, the beauty of a math box is that they are live, that is that the calculations are redone anytime there's a change in any one of these things. And you'll see Frank later on using this idea that we're establishing or setting up here. He will use it in documents that you'll be able to download after the webinar. So now because my command here has a variable in it, that is the slider, if I change the slider, this calculation will be updated, which means it will be reflected in here. So if I change it, you see now we get different samples each time. I know that it's changing from 50 to 51 and 52. That's not going to make a lot of difference. And part of the study design, if you're a teacher in Victoria, is to give the students an idea of this sampling distribution. And I think we're seeing a good example of that now. The other thing we might be interested in is what would happen to this if we took more. So if Stephen lashed out and bought a lot more of these for his class, well, I don't want to go up in steps of 1 in that case. Let's jump up in steps of 50. We'll see a much bigger impact. So I'll click in here. Now I've taken 100. So this is like Stephen going out and buying 100 bags and the students opening them up and counting how many, or the proportion of blue M&Ms in each one. Now this is not proportions down the bottom, I've just left them as quantities. So this would be 13 out of 100, 14 out of 100, 15 out of 100 and so on. The reason why I've done that is because the numbers become a little bit messy once I start putting them as decimals in that way. So I've got 150 samples, so we still see that where it's being a proportion of 12 or 13 out of 100 in this case, are coming up as blue beanies. And we can see the more samples we're taking, the more this is looking like perhaps a normal distribution. We can also see that the most frequently occurring results are around about 12 or 13 beanies out of our bag of 100. Now, there's a little trick that you need to do if you want to see the normal distribution for this. That is, change your graph to a histogram and then under the Analyze menu you'll see down here Show Normal PDF, and that will plot an approximate normal distribution straight over the top of our samples. And we can see here that it's normally distributed with a mean of about 12.5, so 12.5 beanies per 100. And here's our standard deviation over here. Now that standard deviation is reflective of this as a quantity, not a proportion. So I would need to change that to proportions. That can be fixed really easily by just dividing each one of these by 100. I'll do that so you can see where I'm coming from. And then back here, it looks as though everything's disappeared. You've just got to do a zoom data to do it, to get back. And you can see we've got to now mess around with bin widths and everything. That's why in mine, I've just left them as whole numbers to save mucking around in this webinar to set up this demonstration. So there's our 12.2 per 100. Let's go back, because now we've had a look at what happens when we start sampling a large quantity. We can come back here. Now, one of the conditions, and as I said before, why did I take their bags of 100? Because to get an approximately normal distribution, we need a couple of conditions to be met. Now, Frank's going to have a closer look at those in a few moments. But here's a rule of thumb, if you like, that we need NP to be greater than 10, and also N times 1 minus P. Now, I have read other rules of thumb. Frank and I discussed this before the webinar, but these are certainly the ones that VCAR are using. So if you consider the example that we've got here, we've got a bag of 100, proportion of 1/8, so that gives us about 12. So we're satisfied there being bigger than 10, and clearly 100 times 7/8 is bigger than 10. So those conditions are set. The other one just below that is that the sample or the population needs to be bigger than I guess, let me reword that. If we're taking a sample of 100, we couldn't have the population being just 500. We then get caught up in things like sampling without replacement. So we need the population size to be a lot bigger than the sample that we're taking. Otherwise, we get problems about sampling without and with replacement. One other thing I'm going to have a look at before I hand over to Frank is what happens if, say, for example, Renee's teacher, teaching two methods class, coincidentally, and 50 students, but she's gone out and bought bags with 250 beanies in a bag. What difference would that make to our distribution, our sampling distribution? Are we more or less certain about the number of blue beanies or the proportion of blue beanies that would be in these bags? What would they look like if plotted? So we can change these parameters fairly easily. Let me go back, and that's this value here, 250. Again, I'll need to change this because it jumps out of our window. Zoom data. We can see we're still normally distributed. We can see our means changed here, or our proportion, 31 out of 250 beanies. So if you do go to the extent of plotting these as proportions instead of the quantity, you'd see that that would still come out as our roughly a 0.125, a 1/8. So that's the advantage of plotting them as proportions. And it means that we're not going to see a change in this value, but we would certainly see some changes perhaps happening over here. And Frank's going to talk about what happens with our standard deviation. But if we take that 31 and divide it by 250, we can see that the proportion, oh, that's good. Let me do an approximate calculation. We're still getting about 0.125, close to our 1/12 in our proportion. And that's the thing that we want students to see, is that these samples are a good estimate of our population proportion, and then we want to be have some level of confidence about that as well, and that's what Frank is also going to talk about, is confidence intervals. So I'm almost done there. Let me just jump back down to here. So we can draw comparisons by looking at different size samples. and what impact that has. And we note from our distributions that they are centered around P, our proportion, for both bag sizes. So we saw 12.5 to 13 when we're sampling in 100, and then when we chose a bigger sample, we're still getting our 12.5. Now, the small technical details there, if you want to take students through this one, there's our justification as to why we can change this sample and see that the proportion still comes out as P. I guess it depends on how technical your students are. I suspect for some Year 11 methods, that sort of stuff will be a little bit scary for them, but it is, I understand, in the course. Are you there, Frank?
Yeah.
Yeah, that particular part is in the methods course. I'm correct in saying that, aren't I?
In Year 12, yes.
Yes, in Year 12, yeah. So if you're looking at students in Year 12, they are required to know this. I doubt that they'd be required to prove that for a sampling distribution in an exam, but there has been, I think, questions in the past around this sort of an idea. So I think that's a good spot for me, and I'm about out of time, so I'm going to transfer back to Frank in just a moment. And Frank is going to talk more about confidence intervals and also the standard deviation and standard error associated. So I'm over to you, Frank.
Thank you. Okay, I'll just share my desktop. While I'm doing that, good evening everyone and welcome to the webinar. Now, I'm not sure that I'm on yet, am I?
It's coming through, just give it a moment.
Okay, a bit slow. Can you see my desktop as yes?
Not yet.
No, but just while Frank's desktop is coming up, hopefully that the button pressing section then was slow enough that people could follow by hand. Now, Frank's document is a pre-prepared document, so we will find that that will probably go a little bit faster. So the intention with Frank's presentation is not to be able to create the document. You will use the one from the webinar. I think that's fair to say, isn't it, Frank?
That's right, yes.
Yep. Okay. All right, we can see your screen, Frank.
Okay, thank you. Now, what I'm going to be presenting today is just an abridged version of some activity packs that I wrote for the senior curriculum-inspired part of the TI website. So you can download those documents. You can either just Google senior curriculum-inspired and look for them, or I've also got that bit.ly link down the bottom here. The activity packs not only have the TI-Nspire file, they've also got a student worksheet and they've got teacher notes. Okay, now with Peter's presentation, we saw the importance of simulating repeated random sampling if students are to develop a really good conceptual understanding. So why do the repeated random sampling? Well, in statistical inference, and this is I think what Peter was illustrating, we want to know the trustworthiness of a procedure by asking what will happen if we repeat it many times. And that leads to the idea of the sampling distribution that Peter was demonstrating. So the sampling distribution is the distribution of values taken by the statistic, in this case the sample proportion, in all possible samples of the same size from the same population. So when we do the repeated random sampling, or when we simulate the repeated random sampling and we see the distribution, what we can do is it helps us to imagine all these samples that we didn't take. So for example, when the pollsters were taking opinion polls before the recent election, they were only taking the one poll, albeit a very large one. In order to understand how sampling behaves, you really need to understand the sampling distribution, because that allows you to imagine all the samples that the pollsters could have taken but didn't take. Okay, so I'm going to start off with an example, and this time I'm going to assume the population proportion. So I'm going to assume that in a particular large population, 50% of people are supporters of a certain proposal. Suppose that I take random samples of size 50. So P denotes the population proportion. So P is 0.5. Now, normally, we don't know the population proportion. If we knew the population proportion, we wouldn't have to do the sampling. But the reason we're assuming it is to help us understand how sampling behaves. Okay, so X, as Peter pointed out, it's the random variable that denotes the number of successes, in this case supporters. In Peter's case, the successes were blue beanies. And introduce the idea of the random variable for the sample proportion. And we're not going to call that P, we're going to call that P hat. So capital P hat is the random variable for the proportion of successes in samples. The lowercase p hat denotes the values that the random variable can take. And that's something that's going to be, that might cause students a bit of confusion initially, the difference between the random variable and the values that it can take. Now, as Peter pointed out, when you have a sample proportion, that is the point estimate of the true population proportion. It's just a single estimate. Now, I'm going to simulate taking repeated random samples. I'm taking samples of size 50. So once again, I've used random binomial. And I'm only going to take them one at a time. And here I've also got the P hat, the population proportion. So I've taken one sample so far. That's why it says K equals 1. And it was 0.42. I'll do that again. I'll take a second sample. And what we've got here is the mean of the samples that I've got so far. So this is the true population proportion, 0.5, and this is the average or the mean of the samples. Now, so far I've only taken two. And I'll keep taking more samples. And by doing them one at a time, students can see the sampling distribution or a simulation of the sampling distribution emerge. And they also see that as you take more and more samples, the mean converges towards the value P, which is what Peter was showing with the algebra. So this is basically a demonstration of the algebra that Peter was showing in the earlier slide. Okay, now in my opinion, I think it's useful for students to build up the distribution one sample at a time, and once they've understood that, then of course just bang in instead of putting in the syntax comma 100, and they can go bang 100 at a time. Now the other thing I wanted to illustrate, apart from the fact that why the expected value of P hat is P. The other thing is, you'll notice that these point estimates are very unlikely to be exactly equal to the true population proportion. So just giving a point estimate is not all that useful. As we see here, we only got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So only 5 of them were exactly equal to the true population proportion. It's much more useful to give an interval, rather than just a point estimate, an interval where the interval is likely to contain the true population proportion to within a certain level of confidence. Okay, now the other thing I wanted to illustrate with this, the approximate normality. Now Peter's already shown you that we can go to menu and we can go analyze. We can go plot type, we can change it to histogram, and then select normal PDF. You've already seen that, so I was going to show you another way of testing the normality, and that is from the dot plot, if I do control menu so that I get the context menu, and I go normal probability plot, then you get this plot here, which shows the expected value of Z, so the expected value if it were normally distributed against the actual value. And the closer the points are to the line, the better that you can model that distribution with the normal distribution. I'll just do Control Z and I'll undo that. Okay, so that was just a couple of things that I wanted to illustrate. Now, the way I created that doing one at a time was just capture. I just used data capture to capture the values in the spreadsheet as they were created. If I wanted to reset, I can just go enter, enter, and it's reset. And the reason I say that is because if you download the file and you want to reset it, that's how you do it. Okay, and this is what I was saying earlier. If I wanted to do 100, I just put 100 in there and bingo, all 100 appear at once. But I think that in the first instance, I think it's probably useful for students to see the distribution appearing one at a time. Okay, so we saw in that simulation that as you get more and more samples, the mean of the samples, or the expected value of the distribution, converges to the actual population proportion, that 0.5, the value p. And that just arises from the expectation algebra. By the way, if you're doing mathematical methods in Victoria, you don't have to do the expectation algebra formally. You only have to do it fairly informally, just so that students understand that it makes sense that if I have the expectation of A times X is A times the expectation of X. So just doing that with a few simple examples suffice. Okay, now the other one I'm going to have a look at is the variance. Now, as Peter pointed out, X is a binomially distributed random variable. Either people are supporters or they're not supporters. Or in Peter's example, either the beanie was blue or it wasn't blue. So the variance, using a bit of variance algebra, students just need to, through a few examples, realize that the variance of A times X is A squared times the variance X. So using a bit of variance algebra, it's 1 on N squared variance of X. Now, the variance of a binomial random variable, they should know, it's NP times 1 minus P. We cancel some N's, and we end up with this result, p times 1 minus p divided by n. So that's the variance. So in terms of a measure of spread of the distribution of sample proportions, this is a key result. The standard deviation of p hat is the square root of p 1 minus p over n. Very, very important result. Okay, so how does the sample size influence the distribution of sample proportions? Now, this is something that Peter hinted at earlier. So let's fix P at 0.5, and I'll change the sample size. So I'll go 10 through to 250. So I've set up this slider, and I start off with samples of size 10. Each time I've got 200, so there are 200 samples of size 10, size 20, 30, and so on. And we can see that as we increase the sample size, the spread decreases quite dramatically, which shouldn't surprise us, because if we have a look at the formula, let's go back to the formula, we've got an n down the bottom. So as n approaches infinity, we should be able to predict what's going to happen. Okay, so a very large number on the bottom is going to result in a smaller value. And this is the same, this is exactly the same thing, except this time I've got a histogram. Okay. And you can see the effect. And once again, I could fit a normal distribution, a normal PDF curve, the bell-shaped curve, if I wanted to Oops. Here we go. And we can see the approximate normality as we change. And we see that it does become more symmetric. So the distribution becomes more narrower and more symmetric, less spread and more symmetric as the sample size increases. We can also do this, we can also have a look here. If I change the sample size, this is a notes page, by the way. So with 10, that's my standard deviation, 0.158. Size 20, we can see a significant reduction. Size 30, and we can see that the standard deviation becomes a lot smaller as you increase n, which it's just verifying what we saw in the simulation. Okay, so conclusion, for a given value of p, the spread and symmetry of sampling distribution of p hat depends on the sample size. The spread decreases as the sample size increases, while the symmetry increases with sample size. And we can see, in terms of the algebra, it makes sense. So how does p, how does the value of p, the population proportion, influence the distribution of sample proportion? Well, we can do a simulation to investigate that. So this time, with this simulation, I can change the sample size, and I can also change the population proportion. And now you might see why I started with 0.5. So I start with 0.5, and I'll decrease. Okay, so keeping n constant. All right, so see that it certainly becomes less and less symmetrical as we move away from 0.5 and keep the sample size constant. Now, with a particular value of p, of course, if I increase sample size, it does become more symmetric. Okay, so even when I have a fairly extreme value of p, by increasing the sample size, it does become more symmetric. And I think that's significant for one of the things that Peter has already mentioned, which was, when is it reasonable to assume a normal distribution model for the distribution of sample proportions? Okay, this is exactly the same thing, except this time I just have the histogram. So once again, if you download this file, you can superimpose a normal PDF and see that it really does become more symmetric as you increase sample size. It becomes less symmetric as the value of p moves away from 0.5. Okay, and here you've just got some statistics to support that. Right, so conclusion, for a given sample size, the spread and symmetry of the sampling distribution of p hat depends on the population proportion. The spread is greatest at 0.5, so it's got the greatest spread, but it also becomes more symmetric at 0.5. Now, the fact that it's got the greatest spread at 0.5 becomes significant later on, when we start looking at the maximum margin of error in a confidence interval. Now, what we saw with those simulations, and I did them very quickly, but if you download the files, you can go through them more slowly and savour them. Both N and P influence the approximate normality of the distribution of P hat. So for what values of N and P is it reasonable to model this with a normal distribution? And as Peter pointed out, there is no clear-cut answer. Now, as a guide, many statisticians use that NP is greater than 10, NP times 1 minus P is also greater than 10. But of course, normally you don't know the value of P when you're sampling. So what that translates to is your sample should be such that your sample should contain at least 10 successes and at least 10 failures. And that's the sort of rule of thumb which the AMSI modules, if you haven't had a look at the AMSI modules, that's AMSI, AMSI, Australian Mathematics and Sciences Institute, I do recommend that you Google that. So it's AMSI inference, and download those. And that's the rule of thumb they use. Many statisticians, though, say that that's a bit too liberal. Some of them are actually saying that you really should be looking at least 15 successes and at least 15 failures. However, I think for our students, 10 will suffice. Okay, so now we're looking at confidence intervals for sample proportions, and basically just repeated there in blue what I said earlier, that point estimates are unlikely, possible but unlikely, to be exactly true population proportion, so therefore we give an interval likely to contain the true population proportion to within a certain level of confidence. Okay. The other things that I did leading up to this was looking at a simulation for the precision of p hat. So in this case, what I've done, so here, this isn't a confidence interval, this is looking how valid is it to, how good is p hat as a predictor of p. So here I've got, this time p is 0.3, and I've got p plus 2 standard deviations, p minus 2 standard deviations. You can keep taking samples and see how many are outside the, here we've had one sample so far that's more than 2 standard deviations from p, and so on. So this simulation is to look at the precision of p hat. So we see that we have 3. And you'd expect out of 100, in 100 samples, that about 5 would be outside 2 standard deviations from p. But that's the precision of p hat. But what we're really, in other words, the precision of the estimator. But we're not really concerned about the estimator. What we're more interested in, if we're, say, a polling organisation, is p, the population proportion. So what we're looking at is how confident can we be about the population proportion being within a given interval. Okay, now, concept of standard error. Now, the standard deviation, we came up with the formula, the square root of p1 minus p over n. Only one problem with that, big problem, that normally we don't know the value of p. So what we do is we estimate the value, or we replace the value of p by the value of p hat from our sample and use that as an estimate of the standard deviation. And we call that the standard error. So what the standard error is the standard deviation, is an estimate of the standard deviation by using our value of p hat, our sample, our proportion from our sample, in place of our population proportion. And I've got another simulation which shows whether that's good or bad. So how good, or comparing the actual standard deviation and the sample error. So I've got p plus or minus 2 standard deviations, p plus or minus 2 standard errors, and I do different samples. Aha, for that particular sample, the two are fairly different. But most of the time, for most samples, they're pretty close. Okay, there's another one where they're not so close. Okay, so the standard error, so this simulation illustrates that the standard error is a fairly reasonable approximation to the standard deviation. our confidence level. Now, the reason it's important to make sure that we can model sampling distribution as a normal distribution is because then we can transform that into a standard normal using the formula that we all know, Z equals X minus mu over sigma, and that allows us to then from the standard normal have a look at the multiplier for our standard variable. So the quantile from the standard normal for different levels of confidence. So here I've got my confidence level. Start with a confidence level of 95%. So for 95%, the quantile for the standard normal distribution, we often say it's 2, it's actually 1.96. For a 95% confidence level, multiplier is 1.64, and so on. Okay, so if we want 75%, 1.15 is the multiplier. So now we're ready to start looking at confidence intervals, except we need to go look at the idea of margin of error. So the margin of error is the distance from the sample estimate p hat, from our point estimate, to the endpoints of the confidence interval. So to work out the margin of error, it's just our z, our quantile from the standard normal, times our standard error. So our confidence interval is p hat, our point estimate plus or minus our margin of error. And if you have a look at all the opinion polls that were published recently, if you look at fine print, they all post a margin of error of somewhere between 2 and 3%. Okay, so 95% confidence intervals. So what we're going to do is simulate random samples that where n is 200. So we're sampling 200 from a population where the population proportion is 0.3. Okay, so this is my first sample. So the red dot is the point estimate, and these are the endpoints of the 95% confidence interval. And here I have the true population proportion. Now this 95% confidence interval contains the population proportion. It crosses the light blue line. Okay, let's draw another one. So just this one. So that's my point estimate. That's my endpoints. And the distance from the red dot to the endpoint is the margin of error. Okay, and students can continue simulating. Aha, so that's my first interval that did not contain the true population proportion. And keep drawing samples. And instead of just looking at the point estimates this time, I'm looking at the confidence interval. Ah, another one. Okay, so in a 95% confidence interval, we would expect that out of 100 confidence intervals that I generate, approximately 95 of them will contain the true population proportion, and about 5 of them will not. All right, so a 95% confidence interval means that a random confidence interval has about a 95% chance of containing the population proportion. However, as Peter pointed out earlier, once you have calculated a confidence interval, it either contains the true population proportion or it doesn't. It is no longer about probability. So for example, with this one, now that it's been calculated, it doesn't contain the population proportion. Probability doesn't come into it. What's the probability that the next one will contain the population proportion? 95%. Okay, so the 95% refers to the confidence with which we can expect the process to generate an interval that contains the true population proportion. Okay, and you can have a look at this in detail by downloading the site. Now this one here just shows that the maximum value of the standard error occurs when p is 0.5, so therefore the maximum margin of error is z divided by 2 over root n, which is great for pollsters because it means that they know that it doesn't get any worse than that. There is actually that, there is an upper bound to how bad a margin of error can be. Okay, so other confidence intervals. So this time I've done the same thing, except I've got a 99% confidence interval, a 95%, 75-50, and we can see that the wider the interval, the less likely it is to contain, so the more likely it is to contain the true population proportion. So there is a trade-off between the level of confidence and the margin of error. If you want a lot of confidence, then you have to accept greater error. Okay, and it goes on, and you can have a look at that yourself. But I'm out of time, so I hope that I've whetted your appetite, at least enough for you to go to the Senior Curriculum Inspired website and download the files with the student and teacher worksheets. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Okay, there is just 1 minute. I'm going to sneak something in there, Bajana. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Let me just share my desktop.
Mm-hmm.
Because Frank mentioned the website, and it was remiss of me. I said I would, and I forgot. So I'm just catching up on one of the things that I forgot to do earlier. So hopefully in front of you now, you can see the Australian Curriculum Inspired website. You can get there through here, that's the Australian curriculum one. The senior curriculum one is here. So this is on the Australian website. Go to teachers, senior curriculum, and then you'll see down here we can pick up Victoria. Other states will come on board throughout the year. And I've clicked on Year 12 methods, and Frank has a couple of lovely activities in here, introducing sample proportions, distribution of sample proportions, and the last one he was just presenting, which was confidence intervals for proportions. You can see they've just been added up fairly recently. In fact, if you look closely at the date, very recently indeed. And the other thing I wanted to mention to people, because there's been a few people on the chat asking about catching up on this webinar. So the webinars, so I should just jump back to our website. Were you registered for the webinar? So if I was going from our homepage and we go into webinars, you can then choose to see the upcoming ones, or you click over on demand and you can pick up on past webinars over here. The other spot we have them is on the Texas Instruments Australia YouTube channel. So you can see there's some mathematical concepts that students can explore and or teachers, and you can see some of our past webinars. There's one from Further Maths that was quite popular. Almost 500 people watching that one. Let's see how many watch this one. So that's where you can pick up on them, either direct from our website or go onto YouTube, and you can fast forward, play, pause, so you can follow the instructions along. So I'll stop sharing my desktop and send it back to you. Thanks, Bajana.
Thank you very much, Peter. And waiting for the ball to get to me. I still can't see it. There it is. So I'll share my screen and back to the PowerPoint. So
Bajana is getting her screen ready. There was another question I noticed someone asked about standard error and whether that's in the mathematics methods course in Victoria.
Mm-hmm.
It does come up on page 74. I had a quick scan for it because I knew I'd seen it. And it says that teachers are more than welcome to discuss it. And it says, the actual thing says, the term standard error may be used, but is not necessarily required. So in other words, Frank's given us a good bit of detail. I think it's important for students to understand it as Frank has gone through. So I think it is a very useful thing. But by looks of that, I suspect that they would not be examining it because this is not required.
Yeah. My thinking is, I think what the study design is saying is that it's not going to be asked formally in the exam, but it's something that if students are to understand the topic, they probably do need to cover it.
Exactly. That same discussion has come up quite a lot when we talk about things like coefficient of friction in specialist maths, whether it's required. And just because it's not required doesn't mean that we shouldn't be teaching it, because if it's a part of an understanding process, then of course we should. So, we can see your screen now, Bijana, so it's back to you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Peter, and thank you very much, Frank. I think it was absolutely fantastic. The visualization and the sampling, and that makes all those concepts so much easier. I definitely feel much more confident understanding all that and teaching it to the students. So
you're 95% confident then?
Yes. And also because it is on demand again and the activities are already ready prepared, that's an extra advantage. So please give us some feedback. It is really important to us. What else would you like to see in this topic, if anything? So it will come to you after the conclusion of this webinar. The next webinar coming up, it will be part two of Sampling with Confidence and will be more geared towards specialist mathematics. So it will be looking at the central limit theorem and the distribution of sample means and confidence intervals, including hypothesis testing and the concept of type 1 and type 2 errors. So you will also receive the email within 48 hours with the links where to find all the files and the resources, but Peter already pointed you towards those. And there is more shots here showing the products and teacher center, curriculum inspired and senior curriculum expired, and also student center, and there will be more current exam readiness webinars coming up as well. Plus here we have the YouTube as well. We also have Learn Energize Connect workshops. And if you follow this link, you can see where the next workshop will be running close to you. And you can also subscribe to get the newsletter. And if you have any other questions, these are some of the numbers. So thank you again, Frank. Thank you, Peter. And thank you, everyone, for watching tonight's webinar. And good night.
All right.
Thank you.